In the National Football League in 1979, center stage belonged not to the captains and kings, but to the clowns and jesters. It was a season with ragged edges, full of promising beginnings, unrealized dreams, and peculiar endings. There were games won by a foot and others lost by a mile. 1979 was a mad and mixed up year in the NFL. It was a year when old cliches no longer stood up and time-honored theories came tumbling down. For years, experts have said, if you can run, you can win. Well, last season, the St. Louis Cardinals, led by number 32, Otis Anderson, gained more yards running than any team in the NFC. But they couldn't win and finished dead last in the Eastern Division. It has always been true that the most successful teams make the fewest mistakes. Not so in 1979. The world champion Pittsburgh Steelers often resembled a fraternity touch football team well into its third keg of beer. They led the league in fumbles, bumbles, and turnovers, but they also led the league in victories. In San Diego, the Chargers barbecued another sacred cow. Every season, the computer tells us, a team that passes more than it runs is doomed. Last season, Don Coryell, the head coach of the Chargers, defied the odds and contradicted the computer. Coryell's Chargers passed more than they ran, and at the end of the year, they were champions of the AFC West. To all teams everywhere, winning was still the only thing. And it seemed that the best way to win was to throw. Riding the crest of this wonderful wave of offense were the wide receivers. They were the lonesome cowboys of the NFL, gunning down defenders in man-to-man duels, then galloping off through the wide open spaces. The wide receivers of 79, men like young John Jefferson of the Chargers, and Ahmad Rashad, number 28 of the Minnesota Vikings, an old veteran who led the NFC in pass reception. And when the occasion called for last-second heroics, no one was better than Cleveland's Reggie Rucker.
52 seconds to play. Sight back to throw. He throws it in the end zone. It is a touchdown! Cleveland with 52 seconds left. It's Reggie Rucker!
Week after week, pass catchers proved that dash and dexterity can be as impressive as brute force, and ultimately more successful. No intricate and sophisticated pass patterns this year. just everybody out for a long one. With the gift of grab. Men who could snatch victory from the jaws of defeat.
80,000 plus cheering the Browns on. We're in sudden death. Back to throw. Saib looks and throws it deep to Rucker. He's open. Touchdown! It's over! Reggie Rucker. Pass from Saib. He wins the ball game. A 39-yard.
In a season of startling upsets, wide receivers were more often heroes, hot dogs. Glorious success story of 1979 belonged to the most notorious underdog, the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. Their story began 3 years ago when they were an expansion team composed of a motley crew of cast-offs and crackpots. Their head coach, John McKay, came from the University of Southern California, where he was unaccustomed to defeat or disorder.
We went through eight quarterbacks. Every time I looked up, start that guy. We had no audible system because we had the left guard was from Nova Scotia and the right guard was from, we just picked up from Philadelphia. They barely knew each other's name.
Where once I-formation tailbacks fell into McKay's lap like coconuts, he ended his first pro season with the wilted flowers of pro football. Buccaneer fans filled Tampa Bay Stadium, eager to see professional football. What they got was the hottest comedy act in America. A team that went through life on a banana peel. This living Looney Tune, these 40 Donald Ducks reminded one of that famous punchline. We have met the enemy, and they are us.
It was the worst day that I have ever had on a football field. As far as your intensity, as far as your desire, as far as your knowledge, and as far as caring what you do. And I'll tell you what, guys, Coach McKay won't stand for the best player or even the worst player to loaf on the practice field. If you don't give 100% out here, you're going to be gone. You will be gone.
I never said we'd go undefeated, replied McKay after a winless 1976 season. The Buccaneers were America's belly laugh. They went on to lose 26 games in a row and were ridiculed as the worst team in the history of professional football.
There's a rumor going around that the Bucs are not only playing football poorly, they may be playing it worse than any other team in modern NFL history. The Bucs have yet to win a game. Statistically, they aren't playing that bad, but traditionally, statistics are for losers. Don't use the record book when you make that kind of judgment. Investigate the matter thoroughly. Then you can say the Bucs are the worst team of all time.
But then came the incredible transformation that saw them go from worst to first. The Bucs won two games in 77 and five more in 78. In 1979, Tampa Bay's aggressive defense led the NFC in nearly every department, and a previously pitiful offense was revitalized by emerging stars like running back Ricky Bell and quarterback Doug Williams. The Buccaneers astonished everyone by winning their first five games, and nine of their first 12. Although conservative offensively, McKay's old USC student body sweeps produced many victories in the clutch. By the 13th week of their fourth season, the Bucs were only one game away from the playoffs. and the McKay plan was running ahead of schedule.
Well, the reason I had a five-year plan, I had a five-year contract. See, I'd have had a six-year plan if I had a six-year contract or a three-year plan. And so now everybody says, how can McKay be so intelligent at 5 years? Well, that was the length of the contract. That's how intelligent I am.
One step from the playoffs, this rags-to-riches story began to unravel against the Vikings.
He warmed up. It's an old lady.
Yeah, now, if we have to kick a damn extra point, we get in there. Okay. We haven't made one yet. We haven't even blocked anybody yet.
Place kicker Neil O'Donohue's extra point try was blocked as the Bucks on this day proved unworthy of the Central Division crown.
They got to block somebody in there. Get out there, you idiot! No guts, that's what's wrong with us. We got an excuse for every damn thing we do.
The numbing one-point defeat to Minnesota set off a chain reaction of three straight losses. Angry fans called their team the Chokineers and worse, as the Bucks became the target of gallows humor.
The day after the Minnesota game, Neil O'Donohue tried to commit suicide. He put a gun to his head, but somebody blocked it.
You see my watch? It's been the only consistent Buccaneer since they were born. It's never stopped running.
And what we needed was Newt Rockne, and he was not here. We will attempt to come back next Sunday in Tampa Stadium in front of our own crowd. We've now proven we can't play on the road or in front of our own crowd. So we would like to have a neutral site.
On Sunday, December 16th, under the worst possible conditions, the Tampa Bay Buccaneers had one last chance to right all the wrongs and redeem their championship dreams against the Kansas City Chiefs. For more than three quarters, they slogged and sloshed, mired in a scoreless tie. Then, with 2 minutes left on the clock, the Bucks finally got their chance to cash in on a tie.
19-yard field goal attempt. Neil O'Donohue. The rain has let up a great deal. Awaiting the snap from Steve Wilson. It is a low snap. The kick is up. Players are really whipping it up on the sidelines. This is quite a sight to see. A bunch of kids down there, they deserve it. The Buccaneers are the NFC Central Division champion, and we are popping the champagne. The Buccaneers are Central Division champions. They go to the playoffs.
Just a few short seasons ago, the Buccaneers stumbled into locker rooms like comedians doing pratfalls at Grossinger's. Now they entered as champions of the NFC Central Division. What's that? 1979 was a season when appearances were deceiving. The unexpected was almost routine. Yet one thing remained unchanged. Professional football was what it always had been. 11 men pursuing 11 other men who were trying to get the ball across the goal line. quite often, the winners were the defenders. Men like the Denver Broncos.
We shoot over four, ready? Jump it. They don't need any points now.
Once again, the Big Orange defense was talented and tough. It could raise bumps and cause hard feelings.
Hey, what are you doing?
Get off, get off.
You don't push me off with your foot. The hell is you gonna kick me?
Denver's defense could also score points. In fact, they were almost as effective as the Bronco offense. And because of this, Denver won a wild card playoff berth. This season took its shape from the teams that lost as much as the teams that won. The San Francisco 49ers featured the NFC's third best offense, but managed to win only two games. The 49ers proved that statistics do not make a team successful. This was also true of the Washington Redskins, who were outpassed, outrushed, and out first downed all season. However, their ability to perform the unnoticed yet vital things earned them 10 victories. Jack Pardee was named NFC Coach of the Year because he was able to fine-tune the Redskins' concentration on doing the small things well. Some of the virtues of Pardee's instructions were evident in men like fullback John Riggins, number 44, a 1,000-yard rusher and a devastating blocker. Redskin quarterback Joe Theismann was a former hot dog turned hero. And number 38, Clarence Harmon, personally accounted for winning touchdowns in four games. But while the Redskins relied on time-tested fundamentals to win, other teams couldn't even win the warm-ups. More than one found the neatly drawn lines in their playbooks were meaningless. Game of precision, it is also a game of startling breakdowns and bad luck.
Overtime, Erksleben will take the punt snap at his own 23.
Oh! It's over Erksleben's head. It's at the 10. It's at the 5. Anybody scores wins. Erksleben running. He throws the ball. It's caught in the air by a touchdown. Atlanta Falcons win.
But by and large, wild strokes of fortune do not account for a team's achievement. They result from the orderly application of superior resources. Tom Landry's Dallas Cowboys entered 1979 with athletes recognized as the best in professional football. But hot dogs who cannot back their boasting have no place on America's team. Thomas Hollywood Henderson's lackluster play and brash behavior cost him his job during a puzzling year that saw the Cowboys' reputation knocked around as much as their trusty field general, Roger Staubach. Fortunately for Dallas, heroes are resilient, and those who applauded Roger Staubach's courage were awed by his pinpoint passes under pressure. In his 11th NFL season, and at the age of 37, it was Staubach, the game's top-ranked passer, who kept his team in the battle when the cause seemed lost. Roger Staubach's talents enabled the Cowboys to win their fourth consecutive NFC Eastern Division title.
42 seconds left in the game. Redskins lead by 6. How can you live like this, doing this every week?
This is what it's all about.
No shotgun this time. Staubach throwing in the end zone. Tony Hill, touchdown! Tony Hill! The Cowboys have come from behind twice, unbelievably. The Cowboys have won the East. I ain't never seen nothing like this.
Just another day at the office, Brad.
Yeah, just, you know.
For the underdog, upsets begin on Monday morning. Coaches spend lonely hours with a projector searching for flaws in the upcoming opponent. There are 6 days until Sunday, and this week head coach Sam Ratigliano of the Cleveland Browns faces the ultimate coaching challenge. He must prepare his team to play the world champion Pittsburgh Steelers.
And they're going to enter the 4-5 hole and the 2-3 hole with Franco Harris. Rocky Blyer is a fine football player, but he's an offensive guard playing halfback. And I mean that as a compliment. They're not
first, Cleveland coaches evaluate each Pittsburgh player.
Because Pittsburgh wants to support with Shell.
He's terrific at it.
When they come up in this, we got to get up on top of Blunt. He's just not playing that bump and run like he used to.
One thing that they will use is a weak side tornado where they bring 76 and 67 inside and bring Joe Green all the way out here.
Next, the squad is divided into offensive and defensive groups and given the game plan.
They're not going to be like Miami. Miami opened up their playbook and
when we look at the San Diego game, you know this, that Pittsburgh has got a guy that's not too bad a ball carrier. When you look at number 32, he is not a good blocker. He is not a good blocker. So the thing that we want to do right there is when you get an opportunity to take him on, if he's blocking for Blyer, take him on, get rid of him.
The one thing that they're going to have to do as they look at the Cleveland Browns is intimidate us through the blitz. They're not going to be able to get to our quarterback by trying to rush four linemen. They couldn't do it the last time, and they're not going to do it this time. As we work all week long in preparation for the blitz, knowing that it's going to come and everybody not get excited about it, pick it up, block the blitzes, and that's the way we'll get our big plays. There's nothing greater to knock a thing down when it's cocked at an arrogant angle, and that's Pittsburgh. It's a deep delight to the blood.
On the practice field, Ratigliano's theories are tested.
Triple stack, open box crash. Slip west to the left. First touch.
The Browns communicate in code to keep secrets within the fraternity.
40 nickel double sting.
Let's go, baby!
There is never enough time to prepare for all the variables. Still, Ratigliano must break away to meet the press. The trick is to satisfy curiosity without giving away anything of value.
This is a crucial game, but it's not a critical game.
The only thing critical is depth.
Right.
Who said that one time way back in history?
Patrick Henry. Giving me life or giving me death.
During the week, Ratigliano's roles are many, but his most important is motivator, for he knows his players will be the instruments of victory.
What you should do right now, man, is relax and have a good evening and a good supper and dream and fantasize and believe that you can win.
By Saturday afternoon, nothing more can be done. 3 buses carry the Cleveland Browns down the Ohio Turnpike toward the most important game of their season. Tension slowly builds, and as kickoff approaches, each man must deal with it in his own way.
It's going to be great. It's going to be great for Cleveland. It's going to be great for the ownership. It's going to be great for management. It's going to be great for a lot of people. But what I want us to win it for is you. because that's all that really matters to me and the coaching staff is you. We can win it. It's going to be a dogfight, and we know that it literally can come down to the very last play of the game, and regardless of what happens, just hang in there together. And at the end of the day, we would have taken one hell of a giant step. I'm dreaming again. To Pasadena. Okay. Okay?
All right,
let's go. Brian, watch your blitz now. If you feel like it's a blitz, it's going to take time to get this one off, so you better go to Dave.
There's the dog. There it is.
Rettigliano's game plan works to perfection. His backs pick up blitzing Steeler linebackers, and Cleveland takes a commanding lead. Rettigliano can't relax. He knows that Pittsburgh possesses the instruments of attack to demolish even the most carefully conceived game plan. Pittsburgh roars back to tie the score at 30 and send the game into overtime.
You have two timeouts in overtime. It's no care room. You have two Pittsburgh heads to.
Do we get anything to eat?
Don't get nothing to eat.
Cleveland wins the coin toss, but the edge has been lost, and Pittsburgh gets first crack at ending sudden death with a field goal.
Miss it. Block that son of a gun. Come on, baby, block it. Come on, baby, one time. One time, baby.
Pittsburgh takes the giant step toward Pasadena instead of Cleveland.
Hey, look, everybody get your head up. I couldn't be more proud of you. Hey, look, it's tough. And it was a hard-fought football game. You played the world's champions, but I told you right from the beginning, win, lose, or draw, as far as I'm concerned, you're all that matters to me. And you just got to take things like this, and you got to grow. And sure, you'll hurt, but tomorrow night, you got to turn it around. Okay, I'll see everybody Wednesday.
In victory and defeat, Sam Rettigliano impressed his peers.
Let's get your heads up. Let's go.
For his performance, he was named AFC Coach of the Year in 1979. For hot dogs and heroes alike, the road to the end zone was heavily traveled. This past season, more players scored more touchdowns in more different ways than ever before. There were as many ways into the end zone as there were touchdown scores. But nobody got there more often than Houston Oiler fullback Earl Campbell. In 1979, Campbell scored more touchdowns than anybody in football against defenses designed to knock his head off. Earl Campbell, 1979's leading rusher and touchdown maker.
Thank you all very much.
For another NFL hero, 1979 was the final chapter in an amazing football saga. O.J. Simpson.
I want to tell you that over the years,
I've heard your applause and I appreciated your cheers. And I want you to know that I already know it's what I'm going to miss most. Thank you all very much.
Twilight has finally settled on O.J. Simpson's career. But what matters is not this final curtain call. What matters are the memorable encore performances he has given. Therein lies the magic that was Orenthal James Simpson. Player in history carried the ball more often, and only Jim Brown gained more yards. He carried the ball in the game, the better he got. An entire defense was more likely to wane and lose its concentration before the juice. In 1973, he rushed for 2,003 yards, a single season record that may stand forever. O.J. Simpson, pro football's hero of the decade. For the 16 weeks of the regular season, pro football is just a game. But in December, when the playoffs begin, it becomes a civic movement. And each city rallies behind its team for the final push to the Super Bowl. We're the Houston Oilers, Houston Oilers, Houston Oilers number one. Yes, we're the Houston Oilers, Houston Oilers, Houston Oilers number one.
Hey, hey, Tampa Bay, look at me on the side. Hey, hey, Tampa Bay.
The Steelers easily defeated the Dolphins, but in other cities, the playoffs reflected the regular season as underdogs frolicked and upsets flourished. There was no brotherly love in Philadelphia as the Eagles beat up the Bears. But the next week, the Buccaneers went through Philadelphia like the Metroliner and crushed the favored Eagles with a smartly executed game plan of hard running and accurate passing. Bum Phillips and his Houston Oilers reminded us all that football is a game of guts as well as game plans. Playing without Dan Pastorini and Earl Campbell, and with half their defense playing hurt, Houston seemed certain to lose to the high-scoring Chargers. The Oilers drew inspiration from adversity and whipped San Diego in a stunning upset, 17-14.
I said before the game we were short on manpower, but we were long on guts, and I'm damn sure right.
Guts alone cannot win championships, and Bum's brave bunch was overpowered by the Steelers in the AFC championship game.
Now, I don't think anybody can beat Pittsburgh except Houston, and we didn't.
Houston's season ended in Pittsburgh. In Dallas, the Los Angeles Rams season was really just beginning. Of all the teams in the playoffs, the Rams had the poorest regular season record. But against the Cowboys, they cast aside their underdog image like Clark Kent's business suit and emerged as the surprising new super team of the NFC.
I've been around football all my life. That's the best damn effort I've seen any team in my whole career ever get.
The following week in Tampa Bay, three swings of Frank Corral's foot defeated the Bucs and sent the Los Angeles Rams homeward bound to Pasadena for their first Super Bowl ever.
Get
Pittsburgh. That has been the futile battle cry of every team in the NFL. Not since Vince Lombardi's Green Bay Packers has one team so dominated pro football. No other team challenges its opponents with as many skilled athletes. Franco Harris, Terry Bradshaw, Lynn Swann and John Stallworth, Joe Green and Jack Lemp. They have played in three Super Bowls and never lost. But in this crazy season of upsets and underdogs, who can say who will be the hero and hot dogs of Super Bowl XIV?